because we are kings and our words matter.
Everybody, clap your hands.
Every day with you, Lord, sweeter than the day before. Every day with you, Lord, sweeter than the day before. Every morning now we'll worship. Every evening I'll adore. 'Cause every day with you, sweeter than the day before. Every day with you, Lord, sweeter than the day before. Every day with you, Lord,
every day,
sweeter than the day before. Every morning I will worship, every evening I'll adore. 'Cause every day with you, sweeter, sweeter than the day before. What a privilege to know you like I know you, to be loved like you love me. What an honor to worship, truly worship, from this heart that you have freed. From the rising of the sun to the shedding of the shade. Every day with you, Lord, sweeter than the day before. Every day with you, Lord,
every day,
sweeter than the day before. Every morning I will worship, every evening I'll adore. 'Cause every day with you, sweeter, sweeter than the day before.
What a wonder to live life.
What a wonder to live life. Really live life. Overcome anything. What a reason to live. Really live. Every day, my everything. From the rising of the sun to the shedding of the shade. Every day with you, Lord, sweeter than the day before. Every day with you, Lord,
every day, Lord, every day,
sweeter than the day before. Every morning I will worship, every evening I'll adore. 'Cause every day with you, sweeter, sweeter than the day before.
Go ahead and clap your hands. We're gonna sing a little portion where you repeat after me with our singers, okay? Here we go.
Every day with you, Lord.
Every day with you, Lord.
Every day, sweeter than the day before.
Every day, sweeter than the day before.
Every day. Every day with you, Lord.
Every day with you, Lord.
Every day, sweeter than the day before.
Every day,
everybody join in. Every day,
every day, every day with you, Lord.
Every day with you, Lord.
Sweet.
say it's really sweeter.
It's supposed to be. It's meant to be. I hope it is. And I hope you're in a position where the praise and the thanksgiving is automatically coming out. For some of us it is. For some of us it isn't. Whether you're in the mood to praise or not, you need to praise, right? But it's good to be in the mood. It's good when it's really meaningful and it's coming from the bottom of your heart. I tell you, if you are really praising and if it's really coming from the bottom of your heart, and if it's really genuine, nobody has to force you to clap your hands and raise your hands and raise your voice. If you're really doing it all on your own and it's coming so naturally, you are very blessed. You know why? Because a person cannot ordinarily just like that praise God, worship God. No, that's not the first thing that comes, you see. No. If somebody is really praising God, worshiping God, that tells me something. That they have received blessings from God. That they are thankful for God. Thankful to God for what He has done for them. Not only that, their eyes are on God. That's why they're worshiping Him, you see. Their focus is on God. Their focus is not on their problems. Their focus is not on their worries. Only then, only if your focus is on God, the praise and worship will come automatically, you see. And if your focus is on God and the praise and worship is coming automatically and you are in the mood to praise Him, worship Him, lift your hands and clap your hands and raise your voice, I tell you, victory will come very soon for you. Because your eyes are on God, your focus is on God, your faith is in God, your hope is in God, your answer will come from God. Your problem will go to nothing, my friend. But the important thing is to get yourself in a position where you are really praising Him, really worshiping Him. And you can do that. How many of you believe you can do that? Very easily, you know. If you're standing before the Himalayas and nothing good is coming out of your mouth, is it the fault of the Himalayas or is it the fault of the person? It's the fault of the person, obviously, right? God is infinite times more glorious than the Himalayas mountain range. If you're standing before Him and beholding Him and giving even little attention to Him, little bit of focus on Him, I tell you, praise will come, faith will come, victory will come very soon, my friend. So let us take this time, very meaningful time right now, okay? Take the time to put your eyes and your focus on God. Consider how great He is, how good He is, how awesome He is, how wise He is, how wonderful He is, what all good things He has done for you, for other people, and what He's going to do for you. My friend, praise will come. Your victory will come very soon also. Let us sing and worship. Singing something, our singers are singing something else, right? It's a little bit of, we're throwing a little bit of complication because the things are too simple for you, right? You're all very bright and very intellectual, too smart. Sometimes you look bored. So here's something interesting. Let's do this to the best of our ability, okay? The men sing with me and the women sing with our singers, okay? So let's try that chorus, just the chorus and just the Just us with minimal music, okay? Let's go. 1, 2, 3. I will sing
God of to words, and you are worship King of Kings, the King. You are mighty God, is everything. I will love you well, you're the great I am.
I will bow down
before you.
I will sing God and worship the King. God Almighty, He's holy, He's mighty, He's worthy. Our King of Kings, our Lord of Lords. Oh Father, we praise you, we worship you. Open our eyes that we may see who you are, O Lord. We may see a glimpse of your glory, O Lord. Not only that we may see you and praise you with our lips, but O Lord, that we may see you and worship you with our very lives, O God. Help us to truly worship you, to submit our bodies as a living sacrifice to you once more, pleasing to you in that way. Help us, O God, to surrender our lives once more into your hands, to, Father, remove things that ought to be removed, and to start doing the things that ought to be done, that you are telling us to do. Help us, O Lord, to do your will and worship you in that way, O God. Help us, O God. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, as we lift our hearts before you as a token of our love. Holy, 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 holy,
everybody.
Holy, 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 holy,
holy.
Oh, there is none like you, O Lord. Lord God Almighty.
Glory.
your Alpha.
You are Alpha and Omega. We worship you alone. You are worthy to be praised. You are Alpha and Omega. We worship you alone. You are worthy to be praised. We give you
in this place. Raise your voice to him.
We give you
clap our hands and praise him and give him all the glory in this place, all the honor, all our worship, external, internal, everything belongs to him. Oh, we praise you, O Lord. We worship you, O Lord, with our lips, with our mouths, with our hands, with our voices. We worship you and we long to worship you with more of our hearts and minds and our lives, O God, lived for you. Oh, Father, help us to worship you, truly worship you. Help us, oh God. May the Spirit of God move in our midst, even this morning. And open the eyes of our understanding and cause us to see what we have not seen, hear what we have not heard, oh Lord. And may it enter into the hearts of people. May it convince the minds of people. And may they change their will. May they devote their will, turn their will to your purposes, your plans, and your will. May our will match your will, O God. May our will come in line with your will, O God. We thank you for what you have done already in our lives. We long to see more of your power and your glory and your wisdom at work in our lives, O Lord. Teach us your ways that we may walk in them, that we may experience the kind of victory that you want us to experience, O God. Oh Lord, we submit the rest of this time into your mighty hands. Speak to us through the word of God. May the word of God go forth powerfully in this place. May the Spirit of God move mightily in our midst. Show us a glimpse of your glory, your glorious ways, your plans for us, oh God. We commit the rest of this service into your mighty hands. Take it and use it for your glory, for the extension of your kingdom, for your purposes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Let's continue to worship God by giving our tithes and offerings. Please get your offering ready. And those of you watching online, you can give by clicking on that online giving link and following the instructions. Let's all say this before we give. Jesus said, "Give, and it shall be given back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men pour into your bosom." I believe what Jesus said. Lord, you are my source. I look up to you. I depend on you. So I give to you. Amen. As you're giving, we want to welcome our newcomers. Newcomers, if you're here for the first time in our church, if you're here for the first time in our church, can you please raise your hand? If you're here for the first time in our church, thank you. Kindly keep your hand raised just for a few seconds until you receive a brochure from our ushers. They'll bring that to your seat. Once you receive that brochure, you may put your hand down. Wherever you're seated, inside, outside, upstairs, just wait for that brochure, please, if you don't mind. If you look inside that brochure, you'll find a white card. We want you to... If you look inside that brochure, you'll find a white card. And we want you to fill out that white card with your name, address, and other details. After the end of this service, please take that white card outside to the newcomer's desk. Just hand it over to them. They'll give you a free CD and a free magazine. We want you to have that on behalf of Pastor Sam and the entire AFT family. I take this opportunity to welcome you, and we hope that you'll continue to come and experience for yourself the wonderful things that God is doing in and through our church. Now for an important announcement before we go on to the Word of God. Vacation Bible School, VBS, is starting tomorrow in our church. Tomorrow at 9 a.m. right here. You can see the other info right there, okay? And let me tell you that it will be air-conditioned. You don't have to worry about your children being in the heat. They will be in some AC, you know, this entire place will be air-conditioned. Also, rooms inside there will be air-conditioned. So you don't have to worry about that. Do send them. They will benefit a lot. Thank you.
Romans chapter 12, verse 14. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. We've been teaching on love, particularly about walking in love, loving one another. This is such an important theme in the Bible, because even faith worketh by love, the Bible says. Without faith it's impossible to please God. Without faith it's impossible to even come to God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him, the Bible says. So you can't even come receive anything from God without faith. And that faith works through love, the Bible says. So when love is not there, when you're not walking in love, it becomes a hindrance for every blessing of God in the life. And I believe that's why this teaching is so important on walking in love, because even faith works by love. It's like in this building, you know, there is a main switch. When you turn the main switch off, even if everything else is all right in a workable condition, the main switch is turned off, nothing works. Everything is turned off. Love is like the main switch in life. When you turn that off, everything is turned off, nothing works. Your prayer doesn't work, your faith doesn't work, nothing works. Nothing seems to be going forward, because everything works by love. So that is why this is such an important thing. And we have been considering this passage in Romans chapter 12 from verse 9 actually. We have come now to verse 14. Verse 9 to 13, the verses have been going in one particular direction. It's been talking about our actions, our conduct, our behavior, how we ought to act in love, what we need to do. Talks about our verse 9 actually talks about how our love should be without hypocrisy, and that we should hate evil and cleave to that which is good. Verse 10 talks about being kindly affectionate to one another. That is, the affection we have for one another as believers must be like the affection that we feel with our own brothers and sisters in our families. That family kind of atmosphere must be there among believers, it says. And that we must give preference in honoring one another. We must actually compete in honoring one another. And then verse 11 and 12, we did not go through it because it's talking about, it's going into a little bit of a different subject. But then we came to verse 13 where it talks about distributing to the needs of the saints and the hospitality and so on. But then verse 14 takes a different turn. Verse 9 to 13 is about actions. Verse 14 all the way to the end is about reactions. I think life is full of actions or reactions. It's either action, either acting or reacting. That's what life is all about. Everything can be classified under one of these things, action or reaction. Everything that we do is either an action or reaction. So he's talked about actions, now he talks about reactions. Reaction is about how do we react to various situations that we face in this world. Now here in verse 14 is talking about reaction to persecution that we face as Christians in this world. Now as soon as you read this, you can't help but notice that the Bible is very real and it is very practical. It's not, Bible is not presenting you a rosy picture about everything. It tells you the reality of what it is. We are living in a world. We are saved, but there is a whole lot of other people that live in the world. We live in a very complex situation, made more complex by sin and all the consequences of sin and so on. It's a difficult place to live in many ways. So everything is not smooth. Everything is not going very well here in this world. So how you react, how you absorb things that happen, and how you react to things that happen to you or things that are done toward you, is very important because that determines your success in this life. So one thing is Bible is very practical. I say this because some people think that Bible is very theoretical. It's about theology and doctrine and so on. Theology and doctrine is there, but it's not there so that we can know theology and doctrine. It is there because the theology and doctrine is the basis for practice, our life. It leads to practice. It is to ground our practice on a doctrine. Doctrine is given there, not just to know the doctrine, but to lead to practice always. So Bible is a very practical book, and it's a very real book. And so it doesn't present a rosy picture. It presents the real picture. Jesus said, in this world you have tribulation. You're not in heaven yet. You are in the world. So in the world you could have some problems and difficulties. You can be treated unfairly and accused unfairly, or things may not be always done right in this world. You are living in a world, particularly as a Christian, they may purposely do it against you. That's the kind of world it is, because they did it against Jesus, and the same world will do it against you. Jesus said, in this world you have tribulation, he said. He realized that. So the Bible presents a real picture about life. Now, the other thing is what it says here. When it says, bless those who persecute you and bless and curse not, it is not just a moral instruction. It's not like a good, nice, ethical teaching that anybody can take and do. I will show you later on how that verse 14 cannot be practiced by anyone other than a true Christian who's born again, who's had a changed nature. Anyone else cannot do it. Only a person who's born again and has a changed nature can do it. All right, let's consider verse 14 quickly. Now, what does verse 14 say? I think it says two or three things. First of all, it says that if you're a Christian, you are certain to be persecuted. Now, that may sound like bad news for some people. Say, well, brother, I thought everything good is going to happen to me after as a Christian. You're saying as a Christian, you're certain to be persecuted. Then is it not better that I don't become a Christian, that I do not become a believer? I do not come and believe in Jesus Christ because I'm inviting trouble. I may be persecuted. Well, if you don't get saved, if you don't come to Christ, then there's a whole lot of other trouble. I think this trouble is better. this tribulation or persecution is a whole lot better than what you will face without Christ, you see. I think you will understand it as Christians. When Jesus talked about how if anyone leaves mother, father, brothers, sisters, lands and houses for my sake and my gospel's sake, Jesus said, he will receive it back 100-fold in this time and eternal life in the life to come. And in saying that, he added one thing. He said, you'll receive everything 100-fold in this lifetime, he says, with persecutions. Now, so what he's saying is, I'm going to bless you a whole lot, but the world is going to try to persecute you a whole lot also because you're a Christian. So these are real facts. The world is against us, it'll persecute us, but God is for us, he'll bless us. And he also teaches us how to handle this persecution. So if you're a Christian, you're certain to be persecuted. Jesus mentioned it in so many ways. He says, if they treat me like this, how will they treat you? If they called me Beelzebub, what will they call you? He said, you know. So, persecution is something to be expected in this world for every Christian. But one thing good about persecution, and that is, your enemies that persecute you don't know this. The thing that is good about persecution is, by persecuting you, without realizing, they give you proof in your hand that you are indeed a true Christian. If you're persecuted, you don't need any other proof other than this one fact, that you are a true Christian, and that is why you are persecuted. They hated him and they'll hate you. If you belong to him, they'll hate you. If you're like him, they'll hate you. This is the issue here. Why did they hate Jesus? Jesus was so different from anybody there in his time. He came into this world, Son of God, born, took on human flesh and entered into this world, lived totally differently. He spoke and preached differently. His teaching was so totally different. Look at the Sermon on the Mount. He takes the Ten Commandments, and they've been interpreting the Ten Commandments for ages, you know. For hundreds of years, they've been giving their interpretations, but wrongly they were giving them. Very religious interpretations, wrong interpretations. And he comes along, he says, you've heard it said. And you will state a commandment. And then he'll say, but I say to you. He's not changing the commandment, he's changing the meaning that they gave to those commandments. The interpretation they gave to those commandments. Say, you've heard that the Bible says such and such. You've heard that this commandment means this and that. But I say to you, this is what it means. And this is how he goes about again and again and again. And in the end you read that people were astonished by his teaching. They said, no man ever spoke like this. But all these religious leaders were angry with him because he's completely turning and revolutionizing everything, totally giving a different view of life and different meaning to the scriptures that they've known from the Old Testament. They could not take it. It was totally different. That's why they hate Jesus. That's where it begins. That hatred develops and it becomes a terrible animosity against him. Finally ends up on the cross because he's so totally different from others. He just wouldn't belong to their group. You know, even in this world, if you don't belong to their group, that's when they start hating you. I'm sure you have experienced that. If you're a person that don't want to take any bribe and you don't want to do all the things that a lot of people do, and if you're in a situation like that, and if you say, you keep the money, I'll just work, you know, I don't want that money, I will not touch it, they'll say, who do you think you are? They're angry now. But all those guys that do it, they all hang out together. You can meet them all going having coffee together, talking together. They have such fellowship, close-knit fellowship. They're very tight together. They all belong to that one bunch, you know. And you better belong to them if you want to be accepted. Otherwise, you will be persecuted in so many ways, you know. Persecution can come in so many ways. It can be blatant, open, public. And in many ways, I think it's, the other kind of persecution is much harder than this open, blatant persecution where somebody comes and beats you or, you know, destroys your home or church or whatever, you know. There is other kinds of persecution, more subtle. Have you ever seen that kind of persecution? When you walk into a room, they all look at you funny. No. They say bad things about you. They criticize you for everything that you do. They have nothing good to say about you. They will spread all kinds of things. There's so many ways to persecute a person, and people know how to do it. Among some students in foreign countries, I've seen, you know, one of them told me that he attended a philosophy class. In the philosophy class, there was some discussion. Something about the Bible came, the New Testament was mentioned, and some discussion was going on, this guy said, you know, and Jesus said this or something, you know. And immediately, the professor took the rest of the class to prove that Jesus is no more than just a man, and the Bible is nothing else than just another book just like any other book. There is nothing special about it, and many of the things that are there cannot be trusted and believed. He spent the whole lecture doing that and literally torturing this boy that mentioned the Bible in a respectable way. They feel they're obligated to stand against it and let out a tirade against it because they don't believe in the Bible. This is an intellectual persecution. See, they're very educated. They won't take stones and throw at you or break your car or something. But their words are harder than stones, you know. Intellectually, they can persecute you. Emotionally, they can persecute you. Just because you believe in Christ, just because you say you believe in creation or something, they just, you know, come out against you, make you look like an idiot and a fool, you know, in front of everybody. It's important to them that they make you look. They cannot tolerate another person's idea that there may be some truth to it, you know. They're not kind in considering another person's idea, especially when it comes to Christ and the Bible and so on. So there's persecution of so many kinds. That's intellectual persecution, emotional persecution, and so on. And that is much harder to handle because that can be very tormenting. So Christian can expect to be persecuted. You're certain to be persecuted. And it actually becomes a proof that you are a true Christian. If you are a Christian, you will be persecuted. Even Paul mentions that all those that live godly shall suffer persecution, he says. He knows by experience, he knows that it's the reality. Because Jesus suffered persecution, all those that live godly and dedicate their lives to God will suffer persecution. All the blessings are there, but this persecution certainly will be part of your life, he says. All right? Now, what should be our reaction to persecution? We know that we will be persecuted, but more important is, how do we react to that persecution? And the answer is, in this verse, bless and curse not is the answer. Bless them that persecute you, don't curse, he says. Now, what is the meaning of bless? Now, we've talked about blessing so much here, so that everybody knows what blessing is. Genesis 1 verse 21 and 22 says that God made the fish and the birds and blessed them. That's the first time the word bless occurs in the Bible. And it's very important because it reveals a lot about blessing. God blessed them saying, be fruitful, multiply, and fill the sea, fill the earth, he said, to the fish and the birds. So what is blessing? Blessing is speaking good words. Be fruitful. Multiply, replenish, fill, speaking good words. To bless means to speak good things. Now, if you take that meaning and put it here, immediately it doesn't make sense because bless those who persecute you, it says. Now, how do you bless those who persecute you? You speak good. What do you speak good of? What he did was not good. So how can you speak good about that? You cannot say, this man has done a wonderful deed by throwing stones at me and by trying to kill me. No, That would be a lie actually. You know, you cannot say that. You cannot say this man is a good man, praise God, even though he tried to stone me and kill me. No, you cannot say that because he's not a good man. What he did was not right. So if blessing means to speak something good, and you bring that into this verse and apply it like that, it doesn't sound like it's right. But I'll show you how to apply it. You can't say that the guy is good. You can't say what he did is good, because persecution, no matter what reason you persecute anybody for, it's wrong. It's illegal and it's not right before God. It's morally wrong also. Therefore, you cannot say anything good about the person or his deed. So in what way do you speak good about that person? The way you speak good about that person is you experience persecution and you go before God and pray for this person, saying, God, be merciful to him. Forgive him. Be kind to him. May he not go in this direction and be destroyed. May he be changed. May he be transformed. Do something in him, in his life. Bring him to you, Lord. Change him. Now, if you don't believe that's the interpretation, I'll take you to a Bible verse. Matthew's Gospel chapter 5, verse 43. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus teaches it. And Paul, of course, has learnt it from the words of Jesus, from what Jesus has taught. And that's what he's teaching in Romans. It's all connected, you see. And Matthew's Gospel chapter 5, where you find the Sermon on the Mount, verse 43, you read this. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Can you imagine guys preaching like that? How do you like to go to a church that says, love your neighbor, hate your enemies. Love your own kind, hate everybody else. If anybody preaches, love all the Christians, hate everybody else. Would that be a good church? I don't think so. That's the kind of preaching that was going on. Love your neighbor, which is their own kind, but hate your enemies. They were preaching like that, giving teaching like that. Then it says, but I say to you, Jesus says. He says, you've been preached like that. People have been teaching you like that. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. Look at what he says. And pray. He connects the prayer there. Why? Because that's the only way you can bless a persecutor. When a person persecutes you, certainly he's not good. His actions are not good. You cannot say that is good. You cannot say anything good about that. There is nothing good about that. But the only thing good you can say about that is you can plead with God for that person and say, God, be merciful to this guy. Forgive him, Lord. Do not lay this on him. Do not lay this charge against him. God, be merciful to him. Change him. Bring him to you, Lord. Give him a change of heart. That's the only way you can bless. So, the answer is, how do you handle persecution? The answer is, bless. Doesn't leave it at that. He says, curse not. If blessing is speaking good things, then cursing. Now, if blessing is speaking good things, and speaking good things means praying to God for him, for his well-being, for his salvation mainly, and for his change in his life. If that's what blessing means, then cursing means calling upon God to bring down fire on him or curse him. That's what cursing means. To curse a person means saying, oh God, let him go to nothing, you know. Oh God, bring down your judgment on him. Finish him. Destroy him. Make him sick. Break his leg. People talk about these things just like that, you know, these days, you know. I heard about somebody, one preacher it seems, was very angry that this person has not been going to church, or he's gone to another church or something. So the preacher was very angry. He said, you will come back because God will break your leg and hand one day. and bring you back here. What a God he is preaching about, you know. That God is in the business of hunting down everybody that, you know, doesn't come to his church and breaking their hands and legs and bringing to his church, you know. Wrong picture. Believe me, back in the Jesus days there were people like that, you know. So Jesus teaches, love your enemies, do good to them that hate you, bless them that persecute you, and pray for them, he says, right? Now, turn to Luke chapter 9, there is a good example of what not to do there. A wonderful example, a very interesting story, an event that happened in the life of Jesus and the disciples, which tells you what we must not do. The meaning of curse not is found there. Only bless, curse not. Verse 51, now it came to pass when the time had come for him to be received up, he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem and sent messengers before his face. And as they went, they entered a village of the Samaritans to prepare for him. But they did not receive him because his face was set for the journey to Jerusalem. Now you must understand the problem here. There was a problem between Samaritans and the Jews. It was a racial problem. And you see that in the story of the Samaritan woman, where she asked Jesus, you are a Jew, I am a Samaritan, you know it, and how can you come and ask me for water to drink? That shows that they would not even take a glass of water and drink from each other. That's the kind of enmity and animosity they had toward one another, a racial tension that they had. Now, because of that, whenever the Jews went to Samaria, it was always a problem, you know. Because of this animosity. And Jesus was coming on his way to Jerusalem. He wanted to stay in Samaria. He sent his disciples to find a place there, maybe a hotel to stay there or some kind of a room to stay there in Samaria. And they went in and looked for a place, and they learned that this man is going to Jerusalem. He's well known. He's coming. Maybe they would have received him otherwise. But they understood that he was going to Jerusalem. That was another issue. He's a Jew. Secondly, he's going to Jerusalem. The Samaritans didn't respect Jerusalem. Remember, the Samaritan woman asked Jesus, you know, you say you should worship in that mountain, but we have our own mountain. We worship here. They didn't respect Jerusalem, you see. And so they had this animosity going. So they said, is he going to Jerusalem? He's going to stay here and go there? Forget about it. Keep walking, you know. We don't want you staying in here. We don't want you entering into our town and so on. And when the disciples, James and John, saw this, they said, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them just as Elijah did? How do you like these preachers? They said, Lord, how about this? We are very anointed preachers. These guys don't know who we are. We just prayed for a lame man and he walked. We opened a blind eye. And you've even raised a dead man. So many miracles have been done. We've gone village by village and devils were cast out and miracles have happened. They don't understand our anointing. Do you want us to call fire? You don't do anything. You are bigger than Elijah. We'll do it. We'll call fire down from heaven on these guys. Then they will know who we are. Some people, you know what they'll do with their anointing, you know. But he turned and rebuked them and said, you do not know what manner of spirit you're of. In other words, this is totally against the Christian spirit. Did Elijah call fire down from heaven? Yes. But Jesus says, that's not the Christian spirit. That happened in a different context, different situation and so on, you know. People often quote Elijah for everything, you know. Elijah made fun of the Baal prophet so that we can make fun of others now, one fellow said. As Elijah talked, you know, we can talk today in an insulting manner and so on. No, if you just stop and think about it, Elijah was ministering to the people of Israel who had gone after other gods and backslidden, and therefore he was scolding them about what they had done. And therefore he had to say those things. You know, it was a different situation. Here was a nation who has completely forgotten God and gone after other gods and so on. So Elijah had to say something to them. But you want to have a lesson on how to talk to people that belong to different kind of faith and so on, how respectful you should be. You read Acts chapter 17 where Paul preaches to in the city of Athens, and how wonderfully and beautifully he teaches. He does not come out against them and make fun of them and of the way they worshipped and so on. He simply presented Christ and his resurrection so beautifully, you know. So these fellows said, Elijah did it, we can do it. Come on, let's call fire down from heaven. Jesus said, your spirit is not a Christian spirit at all. For the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. The whole purpose I've come is not to destroy, but to save. And they went to another village. What a great lesson here. I've gone to many villages, and there have been one or two experiences where, you know, some elements there, you know, joined together, and they said, you should not come into our village. No entry into this. No gospel here, no Bible here. Don't come in here, don't bother. We didn't fight with them. He said, you keep your village. Thank you very much. Because there are 700,000 villages. I can go to any other village where they will welcome us. There are many villages where they will welcome us. And by the time we finish preaching, they'll have good food ready also. Such nice people. We go where we are welcomed, you know. We don't have to fight with anybody. We don't have to do anything. The Christian spirit is different, you see. Jesus said, I didn't come to destroy. I came to save. In other words, this is the meaning of curse not. What they were asking is, shall we call fire down from heaven and destroy these fellows who denied you a place in Samaria? You are the maker of heaven and earth, Son of God. You've come down. You're the savior. You're a miracle worker, and you couldn't get a room in their village. What do they think they are? Let's show them our power. Let's call fire down. The calling fire down is cursing. Now, especially English-speaking people misunderstand curse. You know, when in the English-speaking world, I don't know how it is here among people who speak English, but in the English-speaking world, cursing literally means just using some vulgar words or bad words. If you use bad words in your speech, that's cursing. But here it is not said in that way. Cursing is not just using bad words. Bad words are wrong, but it's not talking about just using bad words. Here, cursing is different. Cursing is calling fire down from heaven, calling God's judgment upon people that you don't like, calling God to come and destroy people that you know, that trouble you and persecute you and so on. That is what cursing is. Paul says, do not curse, bless. So you know what blessing is. It is to speak good things. And you know what speaking good thing is. It's not saying that that fellow is good. It's saying, Lord, have mercy on him, save him, redeem him, and so on. You know what cursing is. Cursing is calling fire down from heaven. You should not do that. All right? Now, so the teaching is this. What is the teaching here about our reaction to persecution? The teaching is this, that our reaction to persecution must be positive. Now, why do I say positive? What is negative and what is positive? Negative is this. When somebody persecutes you, if you say, well, so-and-so persecuted me, but I never retaliated. Well, that's good that you never retaliated, but it's only a negative response or negative reaction. No retaliation is good, but it's only negative because you have not done anything. He has persecuted you and you have not retaliated. You have not done anything positive. It's a negative response. It's a negative reaction. Or some people will say, so-and-so persecuted me, I bore it patiently. Well, that's good also. Very virtuous. But that is also negative because you have not done anything. Very positive in that. It's a negative response. It's a negative reaction. What is a positive reaction? That is what the Bible teaches. Bless those who curse you. Bless those who persecute you and curse not. The positive reaction the Bible teaches is not just no retaliation. It's not just bearing with a grin all the persecution. You go beyond that negative reaction to a positive reaction where you actually bless the guy, Pray for him. Pray that he will have God's mercy and be saved and be changed, and that his future will be good. That's the positive reaction. Now the Bible teaches that, you know. It doesn't stop with the negative. The negative is all right, but Bible goes all the way to the positive reaction that we must have. Now finally, how must this be done? That's very important. Now this is where I want to show you how this cannot be done by people who are not born again. It's not a regular moral instruction that anybody can take and say, well, I'm going to live by this hereafter. I'm going to bless those who do anything against me and not curse them. I'm going to follow this teaching of Jesus and Paul and all these guys, you know. It sounds so good, I'm going to take it and live by it. Nobody can live by it except if they're born again and have a changed heart, changed nature. Something tremendous has happened to them spiritually in their nature. Unless that has happened, they cannot do it. Why? Because this is the most difficult thing to do. Think about it. To bear persecution is easier. To not retaliate even is easier. But to bless someone who has done terrible things against you, to pray for someone, to desire to see them changed and see them well and see them blessed and see them prosperous and become different, that is something very difficult for us to do. That cannot be worked out with just feeling, because you will not easily feel disposed like that towards a person who has done something against you. If you're looking for some feeling, you'll never get it. Therefore, you'll never do it. That's why people cannot do it. The only person that can do it is a person who's born again, has had a change in nature, change in outlook, change in every way. Why? Because it's not just a matter of feeling. You can only do it as a result of following after a certain process of reasoning. Because you reason within yourself in a different way, because your outlook is different, because your perspective is different of things. That is why only such a person can do it. Now let me show you exactly how it is done, step by step. In three steps maybe. The first step, when somebody persecutes you, what do you do as a Christian? The very first thing that you do is that immediately you think, I was a person just like him. He doesn't know God, he seems ignorant, he doesn't know what he's doing. I used to be a person like him. I've done very bad things. I've lived a very bad life. I was like him. But God has been gracious to me. He forgave me. He was kind to me. He was patient with me. He could have destroyed me. God could have spoken a curse word over me and my life would have been over. But he has not done it. He has been so patient and he's been good. And today, because of the grace of God that has shown to me in that way, I'm like this. I'm sure Paul was feeling like that as he was writing like this. He not only learnt this truth from Jesus, because Jesus has taught it in Sermon on the Mount and he has heard it and known it. He gets his background from there. But the thing is, he has also practically experienced it, because he himself was a persecutor, a chief persecutor of the church in his time. If you remember, in the first century, he was in the full-time business of going about hunting down Christians, destroying churches, throwing preachers into prison, and bringing them to the authorities for punishment and so on. He was doing it very officially with a letter, you know. That kind of a person. Even when Stephen was killed, the Bible says that those that threw stone or rocks at Stephen and killed him kept their belongings at the feet of Saul, who later became Paul. Looks like that he was the organizer. He was the man behind the whole event of stoning and killing of Stephen. Such a terrible person, a persecutor of the church. So he realizes what he's saying when he says, bless those who persecute you. In other words, he's saying, oh, please pray that God will turn him around, God will change him, God will help him, God will be merciful to him. Why? Because I was also a persecutor and God was merciful to me. I was just like the guy. I was doing exactly what he did and even worse, and God was merciful to me. So remember that, he says. Bless those who persecute you. He's having this in mind, I suppose, you know. Oh, remember to pray for the guy. Speak good things in prayer about that guy. Don't be impatient. Don't, you know, be in a hurry to see him destroyed. No. Speak good things. Pray that God will touch him and change him. He says, because he's himself gone through that. He has been a persecutor, been a terrible person. But God, you know, one time he says that he's the least of the apostles. And then he says he's not fit to be an apostle because he was the greatest persecutor of the church and done such damage to the church. And now God is using him in the apostolic ministry, which is to be the head of the church, establishing churches, pioneering churches, creating churches and training pastors and putting them there and overseeing churches. A man who destroyed is now building churches. He says, I'm not fit for the job at all if you consider my earthly qualification. But because of God's grace, I have this call in my life, he says. So he realizes that. And so he says, if you find people who persecute you, don't persecute them back. Don't just stop with just bearing what they do to you. But pray for them. Speak good words about them. Because somebody prayed for me. That's why I'm like this. Pray that God will have mercy upon them. So, in a way, that is true of all of us. We may not have had a role like Paul to play against the church, against Christ, but Bible says that we were all enemies of God. Did you know that? In Romans chapter 5, verse 10, it says we were enemies of God. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17 and 18, we read that our minds were darkened and that we were alienated from God. Because of our minds and our ignorance, we were alienated from God. We were far away from God. We were against God, actually. And Romans 8, 6 says, carnal mind is enmity against God. It cannot do what God's law says. It's impossible for a carnal mind to obey God because it's disobedient. So we were a disobedient, arrogant people, proud people, hateful people, hating God and hating everything that is godly. That's the way we were, he says. We may not have been exactly like Paul, but essentially we were like that. We were enemies of God. Paul was against God and we were against God, he says. So he says, remember that. You were like that and God was gracious to you. And just pray that God will be gracious to the other guy also. Now, that's the story of the prodigal son, you know. That's a wonderful story that, once again, you know, well to remind ourselves of that, you know. Amazing story that Jesus told about this son who had a wonderful father, who had everything. And, but this boy had a change of mind and he wanted to go in the wrong way. He said, I don't want this father, this house. He hated the house, the father, the father's love and the kindness and the goodness and all the provisions that the father has made. He wanted his share and left his house and went and spent all of his money, lived riotously and spent all his money and lost everything. Penniless he became. And finally ended up with the pigs. Pigs had something to eat, but this guy didn't have anything to eat. Then only he comes to his right mind. Some people have to go to that level, you know. Before that, they'll never come to their right mind. Went to that level and finally he came to his right mind and he said, I'll go back to my father's house. My father's servants eat better than me. I'll go and I'll join him as a servant. So he was hoping to come that his father will somehow forgive him, that he will plead with the father and ask him to forgive him, and that he will take him at least as the least of all the servants. That's the idea that he had. But he had a surprise when he came home. His father was already waiting. And when he saw him coming, he runs and comes and embraces him. This is the way Jesus told the story. Jesus is the best storyteller, I think. The father runs out and comes and embraces him. This guy is dirty. This guy is a loser. This guy is a hateful guy. This guy is an ignorant fool, he is. He doesn't deserve anything. He has taken all the money that the father had made and gone and lost it somewhere. And he's come empty-handed. And the father comes and embraces him and receives him. And he says, forgive me, take me as a servant. And the father took him as a son and gave him the honor that is due a son. Amazing story. And that's the way the father loves us. Every one of us have been a prodigal son, a prodigal daughter at one time. Thank God for God's goodness and grace. Just like Paul says, by the grace of God I am what I am. Every one of us can say. So Paul says, bless those who persecute you. That means when they persecute you, remember to pray for them, because I was a persecutor one time and somebody had prayed for me and God was merciful to me and saved me, and made me what I am. You better do that, he says. That's the first thing. Second thing, this is the process of thinking that goes on, that should go on in a believer's mind when they experience persecution. This is what brings about the reaction from the believer. The second thing is, the believer is now able to see why the guy is persecuting him. Why the persecutor is doing those atrocious things. Why is he behaving like that? Why is he hitting me? Why is he coming against me? Why is he working against me? Why? The reason is this. He's a victim of the devil. This is a perspective that nobody in the world could have. That's why I say not everybody there can follow this verse and live by it. You've got to have this perspective. You've got to have the spiritual understanding. A believer is able to see a persecutor and understand and see why he is doing it. He is doing it because he's a victim of the devil. And he's going all the way to hell. If he keeps on going like this, he'll end up in hell. So he kind of begins to feel sorry for him. See, this perspective doesn't come to anybody except a believer. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, you remember in verse 17, Paul says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature, old things are passed away, all things have become new. But have you read verse 16? It says, henceforth know we no man after the flesh. Hereafter I don't know anybody after the flesh, he says. And then only he says, why? He doesn't know anyone after the flesh. He says, if a man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away, all things. It's everything is new now. I don't perceive everybody like I used to perceive, he says. That's the meaning. Why does he say, I don't know anyone after the flesh? Because Paul is a Jew, and very biased Jew at that. He's a Pharisee. So anytime he met someone, he was like this. He will first ask them where they are from. Are they a Jew? Because he can't love another. Are you my neighbor? Are you my kind? I'm a Jew. Are you a Jew? So he finds out he's a Jew. And then probably he'll ask him, which tribe are you from? And if the guy said Benjamin, he's very pleased because he's also from the same Benjamin tribe. Oh, you're my close relative, you see. That makes him love him more. Then he'll ask him, which sect do you belong to? If he said Pharisee, he'd say, oh, I'm also a Pharisee, you know. This is the way he went about. He was concerned about who the guy was, whether he is a Jew or a Greek or what, you know. Concerned about which tribe he was from. Concerned about what sect he belonged to. These kinds of things. Looking at everyone according to the flesh. He says, hereafter, henceforth know we no man after the flesh. Sorry for quoting it in King James. Sometimes King James has become part of me because so many years I've read that. He says, hereafter, I don't know anyone after the flesh. Then how do you see everybody, Paul? He says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away, all things are new. What does he mean? He means, ever since I came to Christ, I've become a new creature. Everything about me has changed. That perspective of looking at everybody and their race and who they are, and all that changed. Looking at everybody according to the flesh, that kind of thing changed. I don't do that anymore. I don't look at anyone according to the flesh. I'm a different person now. You know, I have a different perspective. Then how do you look at everybody? Well, he says, I look at everybody spiritually. So how does a man look at a persecutor spiritually? You look at a persecutor spiritually, you understand something about him. You know what you understand? You see that man is unregenerate, he is ignorant, his mind has been blinded by the devil, he's got the devil's nature, he's a victim of Satan, he's an instrument in the hands of Satan, he yields himself to Satan, he's in the hands of the devil, therefore the guy is acting like that. He sees what's happening to the guy. He sees with a perspective that he never had before. Because he's a new creation now, his whole perspective is different. New creation means that you have had a change of heart. You're inside your heart, there has been a tremendous radical change. But in your mind also there is a change. Because a Christian is one who's transformed by the renewing of the mind. So the mind is also changed. The thinking has changed. The outlook has changed. So he's got a new outlook. He looks at a man. He looks like a mean guy, a guy who persecutes him, talks nonsense about him, plans to murder him, kill him, destroy him. He's been beaten so many, Paul has been beaten so many times, 39 stripes so many times, he says. Had suffered so much at the hands of Jews, at the hands of Gentiles. A lot of persecution he has experienced. So, he says, when I look at a persecutor now, because I'm a new creature, I look at him differently. How do I look at him? I look at him and I see him as the victim of the devil and on his way to hell. So when I see a person like that, as a victim of the devil and on his way to hell, immediately I begin to feel sorry for him. Let me give you an example that will help you. A real down-to-earth example. Examples help, you know. Suppose a child does something wrong. A little child breaks something very valuable. The child doesn't know the difference between 10 rupees and 10,000 rupees. You may have bought something 10,000 rupees worth and the child will just throw it and just in one moment breaks it. Are you going to get angry with it? When a child does it, you contain your anger and don't even show it out and you somehow manage and say, oh, it's all right, fine. Doesn't matter, you know. You act so totally differently. If someone else broke it, you would have blown it, you know. But because a child did it, you immediately act like it's nothing. Why? Because you understand that a child does not understand. In its ignorance, the child has done it. Therefore, it's easy for you to just forget about it and not charge that child for what has happened. Right? But some people say, well, persecutors are not children, brother. They know what they are doing. They plan these things and they act, you know, with all their brains intact and so on. All right, let me give you another example. Suppose a man becomes insane. He's been doing well, he's an educated guy, doing well. But all of a sudden something happened to his mind. And he's gone berserk. He's become mentally, totally insane so that he acts violently now. He hits on everybody, runs on the road, beats everybody, and so on. Now, if you had a person like that come against you and wanting to beat you and hit you, will you hit him back? Now, in our country, I've actually seen that happen. People hit them back, you know, and laugh at him and make fun of him and hit him back. 2-3 fellows join together and beat. I've seen things like that, terrible things. I think they are insane, not the guy, you know. But actually, if you're a person of some normal behavior, you will not hit him back. Even if he hit you, even you understand that he is insane, what will you do? You'll try to contain him. And if you're a very compassionate person, normal person, if you can help him, you'd want to take him to a doctor or hospital or some asylum or something and admit him there. And help him in some way, right? Your heart will go out for him because here is a guy that's educated and all that. He's behaving like that. Something's gone wrong with his mind. Let's help him. At least put him somewhere where somebody can take care of him. That'll be your approach. And when you put him somewhere, you won't go off like, well, it's over, you know. At least I handed him over there. Let him just stay. No. When you leave him there and come out, you will feel so sorry for him, and you will pray to God saying, God help him. May that guy be healed and be delivered and be well and go back to his family, live as a normal person. You would have a desire born in your heart by dealing with that situation. By encountering that situation, you will have a compassion and a desire in your heart to see that fellow well and back to normalcy. Is it not right? That's exactly what Paul is talking about. Paul is saying, when I see the persecutor, I see him as a victim of the devil on his way to hell. He's mad, he's raging mad. Remember the people, the mob that cried out saying, crucify Jesus. They got to be mad. What did Jesus do? Jesus never did anything. Jesus is not a criminal. But they said, crucify him. The entire mob, Pilate washed his hands again and again, said, I can't see nothing wrong with this guy. Nothing worthy of death sentence. I can't do it, he says. It's not right. But the mob mentality, I think, began way back then, you know. All these slogan raising mentality, valga, oliga, and all that business, you know. Started there, I think. Back then it was there. They said, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him, and pressured him. Finally he had to hand over. But why did the people cry like that? They cried out like that because they were all in the hands of the devil. When 1 John chapter 5 verse 19, there is a tremendous verse. When I first understood the meaning of it, it was shocking. It says, the whole world lieth in the hands of the wicked one. The devil, the wicked one meaning devil. Some translations say the whole world is in the tight grip of the devil. Just imagine, the whole world, every single person, except us, the ones that belong to Christ, the whole world is in the tight grip of the devil. The devil can twist them and turn them any which way they want. He wants. He can use them as his instruments. Amazing. The world will not be able to believe what the Bible says, but the Bible gives you the true picture. The whole world lies in the hands of the devil. The devil can use the world like he wants. They are in the tight grips of the devil, it says. And that's why the mob cried out on that day. Because they were the victim of the devil. And Jesus understood it. And that's why on the cross, when he was hanging there, he had this spiritual perspective as to why they did it. So he says, hanging there on the cross, he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Because they just didn't know what they were doing. They were the victims of the devil. The devil was literally tossing them and turning them to do things. Influencing them heavily, causing them to act in that way. And the reaction of Jesus is perfect, you know. He reacts in that most beautiful way. He says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He understood the God of the world has blinded them, and so on. So you understand that the persecutor is the victim of the devil on his way to hell. You feel sorry for him. The third thing is, you will desire their salvation. This is the process of reasoning that a believer undergoes. When he experiences persecution, he looks at the persecutor. The first thing he thinks is, well, I was as bad as him. I was ignorant at one time like him. I was just as much a sinner like him. God has been gracious to me. I want God to be gracious to him. That's the first thing. Second thing, he understands that fellow is a victim of the devil. Under the power of the devil, he's doing certain things. And he's on his way to hell, and you begin to feel sorry for him. And the third thing is, you desire his salvation, his well-being. Therefore, you begin to pray for him to be saved from hell, saved from that kind of a future, and be completely changed as Paul himself was changed. Saul was changed to Paul, you know. So you have to work it out like this. Instead of doing this, a lot of people are trying to create a feeling. They say, I cannot get the feeling, brother. You're talking about love, but I can't get the feeling. I can guarantee you, you can wait from now until eternity, feeling will not come. You cannot feel a good feeling about a guy who's doing all kinds of bad things against you. You cannot feel it. the Christians, see, that's what, a lot of people think Christians, you know, when they come to church, turn off your mind, you know. Some people think they should leave their mind in the shelf at home. You don't need the mind because you go to church. You need only your emotion and you need only your, you know, some kind of feeling. Don't think too much. If you think too much, something will go wrong, you know, that's the way thing. But church is a place to think. Christian is a thinker. Christian reasons these things out. Christian is not trying to feel something and act on the basis of his feeling. Christian is reasoning out in a totally radical way these things in his mind. He has a totally different kind of reasoning which is not possible for anyone else other than those who have understood redemption and have known Christ and have been born again. That's what a Christian is. He reasons these things out in his mind. That scripture where Jesus hung there on the cross and said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He's hanging there on the cross, nailed to the cross. And from there he says, forgive them, for they know not what they do. It's the perfect interpretation of Romans 12:14. What was he doing? He was praying to the Father. What was he saying? He was not calling fire down from heaven. Is he not powerful? Is he not anointed? Can he not call fire from heaven? I can tell you, if Elijah can call fire from heaven, he can call fire very well. He's bigger than Elijah. Is he not powerful? I'll tell you, he's absolutely powerful. But he hung there from the cross, and there you see the perfect interpretation of Romans chapter 12, verse 14. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and curse not. Hanging there in excruciating pain and suffering, he blesses them. How does he bless them? Just like I showed you. You cannot say they are good and what they did is good, because it's not good and they are not good. The only way you can bless them is call the blessing of God's grace upon them, God's kindness upon them, that God would forgive them, that God would grant them forgiveness. And that is exactly what Jesus did from the cross of Calvary. Now, a lot of people, when you say that, people say, well, that's Jesus, brother. You got to admit that we can't do that. That's Jesus. But I'm Sam, you know. I'm not Jesus. That's what I used to say. That's Jesus, brother, not... You can't expect me to be like Jesus. Do you really expect that we should be like Jesus? He said that. That's extreme. That's not possible. Turn with me to Acts chapter 7. I'll read this and close. I'll show you how a man just like you and I exactly did that. Acts chapter 7, verse 58. Remember Stephen, who was stoned and killed in the early church. He was the first martyr of the early church. Listen to this. And they stoned Stephen... No, verse 58. And they cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witness laid down their clothes at the feet of a young man named Saul. Here is Paul. You see, this is the man that became Paul later on. He was there at the killing of Stephen. Verse 59. And they stoned Stephen as he was calling on God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he knelt down and cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not charge them with this sin. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. The last words he said was, Lord, do not charge them with this sin. This is a terrible sin. He didn't say, these fellows are such good, nice fellows. No. To speak good means to pray. To speak blessing of God, which is salvation, really, for these sinners. He says, do not charge them, O God. Please do not charge them for this sin that they've committed, that they've killed me. It's a sin. It's wrong. But do not charge them. Please do not charge them. What was he thinking? He was thinking exactly these three things I just told you. Exactly those three things. Don't charge them this sin. Forgive them. That is blessing and not cursing. Speak blessing, my friend. Speak good things. never curse, bless. When you bless and only bless, you are headed to a victorious, successful, joyous, triumphant life in Christ, in this world. That's the way to win. That's the way to go forward. God bless you. Let's all stand together. Praise God. Let's pray. Let's give thanks to God. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come. We thank you, Lord, for your word, for speaking to our hearts. And I pray that the word will work mightily in the hearts of people that heard the word today. Thank you, Lord, for you have poured your love in your heart. You have given us a new nature, a new way of thinking. We are radically different from this world. And I pray that you will help us to sort out these things in our heart and our mind, that these things will really work in our life, so that we'll walk in love, so that faith will work, so great things will take place in our lives, that God can use us as his instruments in this world. I pray that every single person here will walk in victory and walk in love, and may they be blessed and be a great blessing to so many. In Jesus' name we pray. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of the Father, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide with each and every one of us for now and forevermore. Amen.